In this video, let me compare three things. First, local web development. Second, web development with classical virtualization tools like VirtualBox and other hypervisors. And third, development using containerization such as LXC or Docker. If you want to jump right into the actual hands-on part, you can simply skip this video. But if you want to know the bigger picture, why you want to start with Docker today, then stay tuned. I promise it gets a little bit interesting. For this example, I'm assuming you're building some web app that might be in Java or PHP or Ruby. This is served by a web server like Apache or Nginx. And the web app uses some database to read and write data persistently, which might be MySQL or Redis. In essence, we can call those services which interact with each other. Your development workflow probably looks something like this. First, you develop locally on your machine. Second, you deploy the code to some server. And number three, the code is then run or served by the server. And number four, if there are updates, you repeat steps 1, 2, and 3. While this three-step workflow is fairly straightforward, there is always a little bit more details to it. Your local development machine, development environment, or dev, has most likely a different configuration than the server, the production environment, or prod. And of course, in a perfect world, you try to have your dev environment as similar as possible to your production environment. It's called trying to reach dev-prod parity. There are usually three broad categories of development environments. For these three, I want to discuss the benefits and drawbacks. Number one, we use a local host OS development environment. This is, for example, install Apache and MySQL directly on your operating system. Number two, you use hypervisors and virtual machines such as VirtualBox and maybe use Vagrant on top of it. And number three, use containers and something like LXC or Docker or Kubernetes. On top, you could manage all of those with tools like Ansible, Puppet, or Chef. So without further ado, let's dive into the first one, the local development environment. A 2019 Stack Overflow survey showed that 45.3% of professional developers are using Windows, 29.2% use macOS, and 25.3% use Linux. I'm a Windows user, and that isn't very significant for the example itself, but chances are that you are in the statistical group of Windows users as well. And it's very likely that your server runs Linux as the majority of servers do. Your setup might look something like this. You have your operating system, and directly installed on your operating system, you have Apache and PHP, and somewhere also directly installed the MySQL or MariaDB to host the databases. If you work in a team, then you maybe have another colleague who works on a Mac. So all in all, it's not very uncommon that the development environment is different from developer to developer, and that then is extremely different than their production environment. Here are some real-life problems you would be facing as a developer between Unix and Windows. Unix uses the forward slash and Windows uses the backward slash for directory separation. This alone caused many applications to break, or at least the need to find workarounds. And there's the file name case sensitivity problem. If you store data in a MySQL database, then the tables are stored in actual files on the system. Unix-like file systems are case sensitive, while Windows is not. That means your database table names on Windows are all becoming lowercase, no matter what. File encoding and file delimiters are different. On Windows, by default, your source code is most likely not encoded in UTF-8 by default, and it has the /r/n line endings. While on Linux, you just have the /n endings. There is, of course, a setting in every decent IDE, and on top, a setting in Git for commits to auto-translate those. But if you ever had a new hire who forgot to set this, you know that dilemma. Also, the temporary directory is in a different place between Linux and Windows, and the way file system permissions are implemented is, of course, also different. And then, finally, things that work under one version of Windows might fail under another version. Now, it hasn't happened to me recently, but at the switch between Windows XP and Windows 7, many things broke because the architecture changed. There are tons of other problems you maybe can relate to some degree. And I don't even have to mention them here. But not everything is outright bad with local development. First, let me say that the performance is great using a local setup. There is almost no complexity or hidden layers to work through. Everything runs native on your system, so no emulators, no mappings. It's also very clear what happens locally, as there are no other layers like hypervisors, guest OSs, or anything else between your file and maybe the Apache web server that has to serve the file. You update the file, done. There is nothing to make, there is nothing to publish, nothing to generate, check in, release, copy, mount, map, or whatnot. It's super easy and super simple. Still, as soon as your project hits a certain size, it becomes increasingly inconvenient. It feels like moving a USB stick with code around, while you could instead use tools like GitHub. So let's see if we can do a little bit better than this. The next logical step is to move everything to the exact same underlying system or platform as your server on all development environments across all employees. The majority of developers would probably choose to use a virtual machine since it's easy to understand. A virtual machine is basically a full operating system that runs within your local operating system, but totally separate from that. The local operating system is often called a host OS, and the one running inside the host OS is called the guest OS. VirtualBox pretends to be a physical machine. It emulates everything, all the hardware, from networking interfaces to graphics and so on. If your server runs Ubuntu, then it's easy to install and download a Ubuntu ISO, install it on your virtual machine, start to configure it the same way as your server, and then in theory you should reach dev prod parity. There are some problems attached using virtual machines as well. Most companies don't have a dedicated team to make and maintain those VirtualBox images, so you end up with some sort of intermediate state where you update VirtualBox images maybe once a year, or every other year, or every 5 years, or, well, maybe never. And to make the developer's life easier and manage VirtualBoxes from the command line, a tool called Vagrant came along. With Vagrant, there are pre-configured images. They are so-called boxes and available as turnkey images to download and use right out of the box. You can also automate the whole download configuration and provisioning step. That's where a so-called Vagrant file comes in. That way you can easily ship this together with your GitHub repository. When someone downloads the repository, all he has to enter is Vagrant up, and it will download and install the right box, provision everything, and done. This is a super simple example, and the problem is those scripts to provision can get very large and complex, and updates are not always so straightforward. Also, it doesn't solve the initial problem. Using Vagrant, your development environment is again different than your production environment, albeit it's already better than Windows versus Linux. Another problem is speed. Especially on older laptops, with a hypervisor, you add another large layer to execute some program in a separate environment. On the plus side, you get a robust separation of your host and guest OS, and you can be very close to production. The guest OS itself isn't actually much slower, but because you need another layer of libraries, another kernel running, and just a lot of resources, you will notice a performance decrease. One of the biggest problems I've found with virtual machines is the configuration drift. It's entirely different than performance. So when you get a new server or set up something the first time, everything is perfect. Then time passes, maybe people start logging into the server itself, maybe changing something, which isn't in your configuration automation or configuration description. This is configuration drift. Your current configuration drifts away from your initial or defined configuration. Of course, there are tons of approaches to solve this problem, but it all comes down to the fact that your servers are mutable. That means they can change while they are running. This is where containers with immutable data structure can really shine, and more on that a little bit later. Vagrant and or virtual machines with Vagrant are fast to set up, and they're easy to understand. It's basically a server on your machine. So onboarding this technique is fairly straightforward. You can map your Windows directories or any directories into your virtual machines, or you can use all your favorite IDEs on Windows and just use the virtual machine to serve the content through Apache or Nginx, or use MySQL inside your virtual machine. If you run your development environment on a laptop, it might become a little bit slow. Sometimes things break from one version of VirtualBox to another. And for me, that was the actual breaking point. And then I started using Docker. So in the next logical step, if you cannot work with a local development environment and you don't want to use a virtual machine, then why not just use containers? Strive for clear separation. Strive for performance with a local development environment, which is close to production. Welcome containerization. According to the Oxford Dictionary, a container is an object for holding and transporting something. And this is also somewhat true for containers in the software world. A container, from the perspective of a regular developer, isn't so much different than a virtual machine at first. It runs a program or a service, such as Apache, in a separate environment. You can map directories inside a container, very much like with Vagrant or VirtualBox. But underneath, a whole lot is different. Firstly, on a container platform, not all the hardware gets simulated, like using a hypervisor. The main difference is a container executes command on the kernel of the host operating system. That means it basically runs on the host, entirely separated from it, which is pretty cool. And everything else inside the guest is separated from the host, including the process ID from looking inside the container. Your container image would include all and everything to run the process, like for example Apache, but would execute it on the host but in a separate environment. And that is the crucial point. If you want to run an Apache, you would ship the executable, like the binary, and all the libraries the Apache needs to run, basically everything except the kernel. And the collection of files and configurations is called an image. And that image is then downloaded and run. So the instance of an image is the actual container. And a container always has one process running with the process ID 1, which is, if you're running only Apache, the web server. And the container runs as long as the process ID 1 is running, and then the container ends. Then there are files. You can, but probably would not have your files inside the container. They are separated from the container and are mounted from the outside into the container. You would not have logs in there. You would not have anything in the container which changes the container itself. Just the stuff the Apache needs, including libraries and the config files. Everything else is outside. Why is this so important? By separating data and libraries and binaries, you can create an immutable system. For example, if you want to update Apache, you update the image. You take the running container down and start a new container with the updated image. Configuration drift can never occur. Containers are short running. They are not getting new configs. They are not getting any updates. The image gets the updates. The container should remain immutable. Images are easy to ship around. They just have everything in there to run a container. That container can be run on a developer machine. It can be run on a server, in the cloud, it doesn't matter. From the point of view from a container, it doesn't matter where it runs. It just serves its purpose and one purpose only. So in summary, and all in all, I would love to say that there is one way to solve this dev prod parity dilemma. It isn't that easy though. With a local web development, you're up and running fairly quickly. If you have just a really small app to prototyping, then I mean there isn't any need for any additional overhead really. With virtual machines, you get a system that's easy to understand and works fairly well for, well, smaller teams. It isn't perfect, but it doesn't require to learn anything really. With containers, you get a very flexible system and immutable containers, which can also be deployed to production or across all your team members. It scales well and can also be used in large cluster deployments. The choice certainly depends on the situation you're in and the knowledge you have. Well, I hope now you know that, you know, why you're learning Docker is exactly for this reason. And I hope you found this video useful. So, on to installing Docker and running your first command.